In this video, we are going to discuss self-assessment question in the chapter of vitamin D, parathormone, calcium and bisphosphonate. The first question, all of the following decreases bone resorption in osteoporosis except the option given are hyaluronate, denosumab, chlorothiazide and teriparatide. The right answer for the question is option number D, teriparatide. Why this is the right answer? The reason is, for the treatment of osteoporosis, we have two group of drugs. Some drugs are going to promote osteoblastic activity. Some drugs are decreasing bone resorption. Here, teriparatide, a parathormone analog, having osteoblastic action, thereby promoting bone formation, thereby useful for treatment of osteoporosis. We have one more important newer parathormone analog called abaloparatide. So remember, teriparatide and abaloparatides are parathormone analog having osteoblastic action, promoting bone growth, useful in the treatment of osteoporosis. The other important osteoblastic drugs are calcitriol, the so-called active form of vitamin D, calcitriol. Of course, calcium also having osteoblastic action. So these are the four important drugs useful for treating osteoporosis as a osteoblastic drug. The remaining options are drugs inhibiting osteoclastic action, thereby preventing bone resorption. That finishes first question. Question number two. Which of the following SERM useful for treatment of osteoporosis? SERM means selective estrogen receptor modulator. So question, which of the following is SERM useful for treatment of osteoporosis? The option given are raloxifene, tamoxifen, osfenmefen, and one more option, clomiphene citrate. The right answer for the question is option A, raloxifene. Remember, all the four options are SERM, but here you should know which are the SERM useful for treatment of osteoporosis. The answers are raloxifene and two more drugs, bezidoxifen and loxofoxifen. These are the SERM useful for the treatment of osteoporosis. Whereas, look at the other option, tamoxifen. Tamoxifen and some more SERM like tarimifen, doloxifen, raloxifen. These are SERM useful for breast cancer. Remember, doctor, raloxifen useful for both treatment of breast cancer as well as for osteoporosis. Whereas, look at the option C, osfenmefen. So, very important, a newer SERM useful for treatment of dyspareunia. Dyspareunia, dys mean pain, that is painful goiters. In some people, when they are reaching the age of 37 or 40, in their case, the estrogen get deficiency occur, thereby they feel dryness of vagina, thereby during goiters, they may feel pain. They call dyspareunia. So for treatment of dryness of vagina, we have a newer drug called osfenmefen, SERM. And last option, clomiphene citrate. Clomiphene citrate is the famous drug useful for treatment of anovulation infertility. It's a ovulation inducing hormone useful for the treatment of anovulation type of infertility. So remember, SERM useful for treatment of osteoporosis mean raloxifene, bezidoxifene and loxofoxifene. Now, one more question based on SERM. All of the following are advantages of using raloxifene over estrogen in postmenopausal women except. Options are reduces fracture rate, avoids endometrial hyperplasia, reduces incidence of venous thrombosis. Option D, no increase in incidence of breast cancer. The right answer for the question is option number C. that is raloxifen. Question is accepted. So answer is option C, reduces in severe thrombosis. The right answer for the question. Why? We now going for discussion of one very important thing, SERM. I go from basic to high. Look at the basic. SERM mean selective estrogen receptor modulator. As the name indicate, there are some drug having agonistic action on some estrogen receptor, and the same drug having antagonistic action on some other estrogen receptor. Now look at the diagram. I given various spots in female body. In that, look at the one drug called tamoxifen. Tamoxifen is one of the SERM. Why this is called as SERM? Because tamoxifen acting as a antagonist on breast estrogen receptor. The same tamoxifen acting as agonist on all other areas estrogen receptor. Here the beautiful point is tamoxifen having antagonistic action on breast estrogen receptor, so useful for treatment of ER positive, that is estrogen receptor positive breast cancer. But look at the extra point, the tamoxifen having agonistic action on other estrogen receptor. So when tamoxifen acting as a agonist on estrogen of the blood vessel, it causes vasodilatation, thereby causing hot flushing. And tamoxifen having agonistic action on endometrial estrogen receptor, thereby causes endometrial hyperplasia. And tamoxifen having agonistic action on liver, thereby promoting the synthesis of clotting factor that causes hypercoagulation, that resulting in deep vein thrombosis. That means the take-home message, tamoxifen useful for treatment of ER-positive breast cancer. At the same time, the three important adverse effects of tamoxifen are, number one, hot flush, number two, endometrial cancer, number three, deep vein thrombosis. Now, look at my question. We have one, raloxifen, very important, very important. Raloxifen, SERM, actually introduced for prevention of osteoporosis. Actually, it was introduced for prevention of osteoporosis. But look at the pharmacology. Raloxifen is the SERM having antagonistic action on breast estrogen receptor as well as having antagonistic action on endometrial estrogen receptor. In other areas, it acts as an agonist. So, raloxifen also useful for treatment of ER-positive breast cancer. But the advantage is, on comparison to tamoxifen, raloxifen having antagonistic action on endometrium, so no risk of endometrial cancer. Whereas, similar to tamoxifen, raloxifen having agonistic action on blood vessel and liver, thereby this also causes vasodilatation, resulting in hot flush. And raloxifen also having agonistic action on estrogen of the liver, thereby promoting synthesis of clotting factor, resulting in hypercoagulation and deep vein thrombosis. So the final take-home message, raloxifen on comparison to tamoxifen superior in the sense no risk of endometrial cancer, but both tamoxifen and raloxifen both are causing side effect of hot flush and DVT. Very important. Next question. Chronic use of which of the following medication is most likely to cause osteoporosis? The option given are lovastatin, propranolol, warfarin, prednisolone. The right answer for the question is prednisolone. Very important item. There are so many drugs may cause risk of osteoporosis. So you should know what are all the common drugs causing osteoporosis problem. Lot of drugs, common drug like corticosteroid, GnRH agonist, gonadotropin releasing hormone agonist, thyroxine, anticonvulsant, some sedative. and heparin. These drugs are generally causing side effect of osteoporosis. Anyway, remember, among all, the most commonest drug causing osteoporosis, think of corticosteroid. Corticosteroids are the most commonest drug causing osteoporosis. Which of the following agents used for osteoporosis should not be used for more than 2 years? Options are calcitonin, denosumab, teriparatide, and zoledronic acid. The right answer for question is option number C, teriparatide. Why? Teriparatide, we know, is a parathermo analog useful for osteoporosis, but look at the side effect. Teriparatide causing side effect of paresthesia, hypercalcemia, nephrolithiasis, and very, very important, if the drug used for more than 2 years, risk of osteosarcoma. So very important, teriparatide should not used for more than 2 years, because long term use having risk of causing osteosarcoma. Now the other options are calcitonin side effect like nausea, flushing, altered taste sensation. Denosumab, a monoclonal antibody useful for preventing osteoporosis, that drug may cause side effect of hypercalcemia. Zoledronate, one of the most famous bisphosphonate, that drug is given intravenously, that drug causing side effect of flu-like symptom, renal toxicity, and chronic use may cause osteonecrosis of jawbone. But remember, the most common side effect flu-like symptom, and also the most serious problem nephrotoxicity. That finishes question number 5. Question number 6. Which of the following agent used for treating secondary hyperparathyroidism? The option given are calcitonin, cinacalcet, teriparatide, zoledronic acid. The right answer for the question is option number B, cinacalcet. The reason is, cinacalcet, a newer drug, it acting as a stimulant of calcium sensing receptor in the parathyroid gland, thereby controlling the release of parathormone. So for treating secondary hyperparathyroidism, we use cinacalcet. The remaining option, calcitonin, a hypocalcemic hormone, teriparatide, we know, parathormone analog, zoledronic acid is a bisphosphonate. Number 7. Which is correct regarding the pharmacokinetic of bisphosphonate? The option given are bisphosphonates are well absorbed after oral administration. Option B, food and other medication greatly impair absorption of bisphosphonate. Option C, bisphosphonates are mainly metabolized via cytochrome P450 system. Option D, elimination half-life for bisphosphonate ranges from 4 to 6 hours. The right answer for the question is option B. I go one by one option. First, look here. Bisphosphonate are poorly absorbed from oral route. Important. And food and other medication definitely impair absorption. That's why this point very important. That's why bisphosphonates are taken in empty stomach. And one more important point, whenever you are recommending bisphosphonate, advise the patient properly. Oral bisphosphonate should be taken only in empty stomach, that is half an hour before meal, and the drug should be taken with a full glass of water. Even after taking the drug, advise the patient to stand in erect posture for another half an hour, because when bisphosphonate drugs touches esophagus, there is a heavy risk of erosive esophagitis. So the drug should be taken in empty stomach with full glass of water in erect posture. This advice should given to patient. and bisphosphonates are not metabolized by CYP enzyme. They straight away taken by bone, and the clearance from the bone going via kidney, and the elimination half life ranges from months to year, not in hours, months to years. So these are all incorrect. The right answer is option B. Question: bisphosphonates are used in all except. Options are Paget disease, vitamin D excess, postmenopausal osteoporosis, hypercalcemia, or malignancy. Question is on except. Remember, bisphosphonate useful or except. The answer is option B, vitamin D excess. Now you should know uses of bisphosphonates. Remember, bisphosphonates are wonderful drug for treatment of osteoporosis, hypercalcemia, and Paget disease. Remember, currently for treating osteoporosis, hypercalcemia, and Paget disease, bisphosphonate are the first line drug of choice. And bisphosphonates also having anti-tumor activity. They undergo trial in the treatment of breast cancer and also in the treatment of CML. So now they undergo trial for cancer treatment also. Next question. Which of the following is the serious adverse effect seen with zoledronate? Options are acute renal failure, ventricular fibrillation, peptic ulcer, anterior uveitis. Remember, zoledronate, a bisphosphonate given intravenously. Intravenously given bisphosphonate, most important problem, flu-like symptom. But asking which is a serious problem, it is nephrotoxicity. Acute renal failure is the most important. Now I go for extra information. Generally, when you talk about adverse effect of bisphosphonate, orally given bisphosphonate causes erosive esophagitis. Important to avoid this, advise the patient to take the drug in empty stomach with full glass of water in erect posture. Whereas our test question, zoledronate is the intravenously given bisphosphonate. Since when intravenously, it may cause thrombobliephitis, so during infusion, risk of fever, chills, rigor, that is called flu-like symptom. But the serious adverse effect is acute renal failure. So before and after using zoledronate, definitely you should do renal function test, because zoledronate having risk of causing nephrotoxicity. And rarely zoledronate can make us osteonecrosis of jawbone, and sometimes on chronic use it causes stress fracture of lateral cortex of femoral shaft. There's a rare chances on chronic use. Anyway, remember, the most serious adverse effect of zoledronate, think of renal toxicity, that is acute renal failure. A patient has been taking alendronate for postmenopausal osteoporosis for past 5 years with a slight increase in bone mineral density and no occurrence of fracture. Risk of which adverse effect might warrant consideration of a drug holiday from alendronate in this patient? Options are atypical femur fracture, esophagitis, osteosarcoma, and rhinitis. The right answer for the question is atypical femur fracture. Look here, alendronate on chronic use may cause atypical fracture of femur. So to avoid this complication, a drug holiday may be needed on chronic use more than 5 years. No, so in this case, risk of atypical femur fracture, so it needs a drug holiday. Now question number 11. A patient presenting with the symptoms of bowed legs, stunted growth, blood test shows low serum calcium, low serum phosphate, and elevated level of serum alkaline phosphatase. Bone density scan shows poor mineralization of bones. Radiography shows cupping of metaphysis. So look at the X-ray and can you make out what could be the diagnosis? Please spend some time. They having bowed leg and also having stunted growth and having poor mineralization of bone, and radiography shows cupping of metaphysis. It's a typical clinical symptom and typical finding indicating the diagnosis of rickets. Now we go for small extra points on management aspect of rickets. Look, rickets we know mainly due to deficiency of vitamin D and also calcium. So normally for the treatment of rickets, we supplement vitamin D and calcium. But you should know one more point. There are two important extra points you should know. Vitamin D dependent rickets, one more thing called vitamin D resistant rickets. Again, vitamin D dependent rickets are two types, type 1 and type 2. Now first I go for vitamin D dependent rickets. Look, there are two types of vitamin D dependent rickets, namely type 1 and type 2. What is the problem in type 1? In type 1, it's called autosomal recessive disorder. Here the problem is defective conversion. Remember, there is a defect in the conversion of 25 hydroxycholecalciferol into calcitriol. This conversion happening in the kidney. So in type 1 vitamin D dependent rickets, there is a deficiency of 1-alpha hydroxylase enzyme. 1-alpha hydroxylase enzyme is responsible for conversion of 25 hydroxycholecalciferol into active form calcitriol. So the defect in conversion causing problem of type 1 vitamin D dependent rickets. For this treatment is supplementation of active form of vitamin D like calcitriol. Whereas type 2 vitamin D dependent rickets is a autosomal recessive disorder. Here the pathology is defect in the receptor, vitamin D receptor problem. So here we have to give parenterally calcium supplementation. Whereas we have one more important type called vitamin D resistant rickets. Here the problem is increased phosphate excretion. This is called hypophosphatemic rickets. Hypophosphatemic rickets. It's a X-linked dominant disorder. Here the pathology is there is a defect in the reabsorption of phosphate from the urine. So this increased phosphaturia, this is the problem. For this case, we have to give treatment with the high dose of vitamin D along with the inorganic phosphate. In this area, I want to share one new information, a latest point. We have one drug called BURO, Burozumab, a latest drug. It's a monoclonal antibody named by Burozumab. It is acting against fibroblast growth factor 23. Normally, the fibroblast growth factor 23 causes phosphaturia, increasing phosphate excretion. Our Burozumab acting against fibroblast growth factor 23, that means the Burozumab going to inhibit phosphaturic action of fibroblast factor 23, thereby useful for treatment of X-linked hypophosphatemia. So one of the latest drug useful for treatment of vitamin D resistant rickets, the so-called hypophosphatemic rickets, mean think of Burozumab, a latest point, very important point. And then question number 12. Look here. A 55-year-old post-menopausal woman develops weakness, polyuria, polydipsia, and significant increase of plasma creatinine concentration. A computer tomograph CT scan indicates nephrocalcinosis. A drug is considered to be the cause. Which drug was the most likely responsible for this condition? The option given are estrogen, atidronate, prednisone and vitamin D. The right answer question is option D, vitamin D, because this condition indicate hypervitaminosis D. In hypervitaminosis D, there will be hypercalcemia. So in hypervitaminosis D, the clinical symptom will be vomiting, diarrhea, polyuria. That causes dehydration. Because of severe dehydration, they feel polydipsia and fatigue and also muscle weakness, and because of hypercalcemia, nephrocalcinosis. This is a classical problem of hypervitaminosis D. And treatment for this case will be, we have to use low calcium diet with steroid. So low calcium diet combined with glucocorticosteroid is the treatment for hypervitaminosis D. That finishes question number 12. Now question number 13. A patient develops marked skeletal muscle tightening soon after a recent thyroidectomy. The attending confirms the diagnosis in part by light tapping the patient's cheek in front of the ear. Stimulation of facial nerve in this manner leads to spasm of the local muscle, oris muscle, that is ocular muscle, called chaustic sign. Which drug is most likely to be chosen to manage this adverse response to surgery? The options are calcitonin, calcium gluconate, parathormone, and vitamin D. The right answer for the question is option number B, calcium gluconate. Remember, doctor, this patient undergone thyroidectomy. In case of thyroidectomy patient, there may be a risk of some involvement of parathyroid gland also. So some part of parathyroid glands also may be removed, resulting in tetany. Now there are two important signs to confirm diagnosis of tetany. One is called chaustic sign. Here, just tap the patient in front of the ears, like here. The stimulation of facial nerve causes a small muscle contraction around the cheek and around the oral cavity. It is called hyperexcitability in case of hypocalcemia in tetany patient. And one more important clinical test is, you just elevate the BP cuff, you just elevate the pressure above the systole level. Once you elevating systole level, look at the, there's a contraction of the wrist muscle and also metatarsophalangeal muscle as an adduction of fingers. So it's called trososeous sign of tetany. Now it's a case of confirmed case of tetany is due to hypercalcemia following thyroidectomy. So immediately we have to replace calcium. For that, calcium gluconate is the right choice. Whereas we can try calcimine, parathormone, vitamin D. They are slowly going to raise the calcium level, so they are not used for acute purpose. They can be used for chronic treatment of hypercalcemia. Whereas calcitonin is a drug going to control calcium level. It's a hypocalcemic hormone, so that has no role in this patient. So the immediate choice for this case will be giving calcium gluconate supplementation. Question number 14. All of the following drugs are useful for treatment of hypercalcemia except. The options are alendronate, mitramycin, calcitonin, and chlorthalidone. The right answer for the question is option number D. Chlorthalidone, a thiazide group of diuretic. Thiazide in general causes calcium reabsorption, resulting in hypercalcemia. Here the question is, all of the following drugs are useful for treatment of hypercalcemia except. So answer is chlorthalidone. Chlorthalidone, a thiazide diuretic causing calcium reabsorption, resulting in hypercalcemia. So today you should know what are all the important drugs useful for treatment of hypercalcemia. For treating hypercalcemia, we can use so many options. For example, loop diuretic. Remember, loop diuretic, like furosemide. Loop diuretic having one important action on the calcium. They loses calcium in the urine. So useful for treatment of hypercalcemia. But when you use loop diuretic alone, they cause a dehydration. Provide this give along with saline. So saline plus loop diuretic, or else we can do corticosteroid or calcitonin or plaquemycin. The plaquemycin is also called mitramycin. It's a anti-cancer drug having role of controlling calcium. So plaquemycin, the so-called mitramycin, is one anti-cancer antibiotic control calcium. But even though these drugs are useful for treatment of hypercalcemia, remember today for treating hypercalcemia, the drug of choice means bisphosphonates. So bisphosphonates are drug of choice for treatment of hypercalcemia. For example, for immediate treatment of hypercalcemia, IV bisphosphonate like pamidronate, zoledronates are very important drug. Remember, zoledronates are very useful drug for postmenopausal osteoporosis, Paget disease, as well as useful for hypercalcemia. Now, one more question. Before seeing the question, look at the picture. I put a pelvis x-ray and skull bone and also the spine. Look at the picture. Now, after looking at the picture, now look at the question. A patient presenting with frontal bossing, with hearing loss, headache, and low back pain. Investigation shows an elevated level of alkaline phosphatase with the normal calcium and phosphate. X-ray shows punched out lesion and cotton wool appearance on the skull bone. What could be the diagnosis? Now look at the picture one more time. There are so much of punched out lesions in X-ray, and look at the skull bone deformity is there, and there's a hyposis. So what could be the diagnosis? The diagnosis, Paget disease. Paget disease, one condition where there is a disorganized new bone formation and disorganized growth resulting in deformity, sometimes pain. So what is treatment for this case? The drug of choice means go for bisphosphonate. Other than bisphosphonate, what else useful for treatment of Paget disease? Think of calcitonin. And there will be bone pain. To control the pain, we can give analgesic agent. And for treating deformity, we can do surgery. But coming to pharmacotherapy, the drug of choice for treating Paget disease, bisphosphonate. That finishes all the 15 questions. So read well. May God bless you. Thank you.